Penguin Random House Audio presents Deep Wood by Elleston Trevor. Read by Gary Martin.
The first chapter, The Badger's House. An old crow flew off from a tree on the top of Lavender Hill, and the westering sun threw his slow shadow on the slopes and over the heath. Across the heath this single shadow swept, up to the top of Bramble Hill and down again over the green canopy of wavering wood, gliding across the still blue surface of the lake and vanishing at last, with the sinking of the sun, into deep wood. Deep wood lay cradled between the two broad slopes of the Sweet Hallow Valley, a huge sleeping cloud of trees. Little copses dotted the clustered oaks. Silver spinneys of birches ran between gnarled and ancient brothers. Here a shady dell nestling in a cup of green banks, where foxgloves nodded the sleepy days of summer through. There a gentle larch coppice, at the meeting of three meandering pathways through the wood, wandering softly, watched over by leaning willows and held in low green banks, ran the wild river, flowing in the softness of tree light, ever onwards to the end of the valley and the ends of the earth. From the coppice ran a pathway, brown bare earth set in green moss and the tumbled roots of vast trees. It turned gently past a bend in the wild river, and followed the graceful columns of silver birches, turned again into the great green heart of the wood, and stopped at last in the shade of a beech tree, whose uplifted boughs seemed to hold the very skies upon its crown of leaves. A shallow flight of steps, smoothly worn by the passing of feet over the years, led from the pathway down to a hollow between the huge roots of the tree. In the hollow was set a little brown door, and a candle-lantern hung above it. A low candle burned in it now, for the dusk was deep under the leaves, and the steps were in warm shadow. The door-handle was turning, and the soft brown wood grain moved in the candlelight as the door opened slowly. Old Stripe, the quiet little badger who lived in the rambling house deep under the very roots of the tree, was coming out for his twilight stroll. He closed the door gently and climbed the steps, his hands clasped behind him, a gnarled briar pipe of his own making, scenting the still evening air with the sweetness of clover and of coltsfoot. A sleepy bird chirruped somewhere above his head as he walked along the pathway. The first of the starlight played upon the black stripes that ran across his white head, and picked the fur-white tips of his ears as sunlight frames the petals of young primroses. By and by he came to the turn of the path, and wandered off down a smaller way that led to the wild river. Above him now a huge black lacework of leaves, draped over the great branches, stood Owl's Beach, where Woo, his friend, had his house. Old Stripe walked slowly on towards the quiet murmur of the river, and the path turned sharply along a wide bank. Here, with the gentle surface of the water before him, the pale light of the night sky glowed freely, for the trees pressed back from the river, and there was no shade. Old Stripe turned along the bank, and saw the gray drifting smoke from a small chimney. On the little island where the river opened into a wide bend, a snug house stood. The smoke curled away from the chimney and swept low over the slow waters. A window gleamed redly beneath the single tree on the island. An otter lived here, spending his quiet days with the river he loved, and making quaint pottery from the rich clay along the banks. Stripe heard a door opening somewhere. The sound came from the island, and he peered into the dusk. A familiar shape was walking quickly to the edge of the bank and unhitching the mooring rope of a small boat that rocked on the ripples. By the time the badger had reached the wide bend, little Potter had brought his boat to the mainland and was climbing out.
"Hello there, Potter," said Old Stripe in a friendly way.
Potter tied his boat to the mooring post and looked up quickly.
"Stripe!"
He trotted over to his friend. There was greeting in his voice and urgency.
"I was just coming to see you," he went on in an anxious tone.
"Ah," nodded Stripe. "Then come along. I put a kettle on before I came out.
By the time we get back, it should be ready."
So Potter joined him along the winding path. They left the wild river and struck into the gloom of the trees. Old Stripe shivered a little as they walked.
"It's getting to be kind of Octobery," he remarked, stamping his feet as he walked. "There's that smell in the air, and the smoke from your chimney looks like Octobery sort of smoke, don't you think?"
When Potter remained silent with his thoughts, his friend glanced at him in the shadows.
"Something worrying you?" he asked kindly.
The otter nodded.
"I was coming to see you very specially," he admitted, "and I hoped you wouldn't mind so late at night."
"The best time there is for coming to see folk very specially," said Stripe, "is at night,
because we can do it round the fire in comfort. What's the trouble?"
"The trouble is a tragedy," said Potter sadly, "and it's about my pipe."
"Ah, you've broken it," nodded Stripe gravely.
"How did you know?"
"Very simple. If you have a pipe and have a tragedy with it, it can only mean one thing."
"Yes," Potter sighed. "Right in the middle, too."
"Then we must see about a new one," said Stripe comfortingly.
They joined the wider pathway, passing beneath Owl's Beech, and made towards the candle lantern that gleamed brightly through the dark tree trunks.
"I thought perhaps we might save making a new one," Potter said, much brighter now, "and patch up my old one."
"Right in the middle?" Stripe shook his head slowly.
"For one thing, it's a bad place to have a patch. And for another thing, I like making new pipes. So we'll see about a new one, as I said before."
An eagerness had crept into his gruff voice. Another pipe to be made. Another jolly evening in the little cozy workshop deep beneath the ground. He liked that sort of thing. It was a good thing to be done in a deep, cozy room with a friendly fire making the very walls glow with warmth and company. They reached the steps and went down beneath the pale beams of the candle.
"I'll leave it burning," said Stripe, "because we shall have folk coming along, most likely."
The door closed on the chill night. The candle burned, its light alone keeping the shadows from the tree. Old Stripe led the way down the wide, shallow stairs that ran downwards from the front hall into a high, rambling passage below. All along the mellow walls burned candles, so that nowhere was in shadow. From this main passage turned other corridors on both sides, leading to many a cozy room far beneath the ground. They say that even Stripe himself doesn't know just how many rooms there are in his old house. Generations and generations of his folk had lived in this house, and each had built more rooms to it. Potter followed him along the big corridor into a great deep room at the very end. A pile of sweet apple logs blazed in the open hearth, and even the light of four bright candles was pale in the room beneath the warm red glow from the logs. Old twisted roots thrusting down from the beech tree above were set in the ceiling. From one of them a candle lantern hung above the table. Between the chain of the lantern and the ceiling there hung a spider's web. It was very probably the only web you would find in the whole house, for Stripe had never brushed it down. For this little home had been woven and hung many, many years ago above the old lamp. The long-dead ancestors of the spider that sat there now had made the web soon after a great-great-grandfather of old Stripe's had made the lantern and hung it from the old root. So the spider's claim to his home was as strong as the badger's to his own. He brushed round it every day and thought to himself how useful it was for keeping the flies away in summer.
"Sit down, Potter," he said with a sigh of content.
He stood in front of the wide fireplace, holding his hands behind him, reveling in the warmth after the cool pinch of the night air above them. Potter rested back comfortably in the settle seat, feeling the warmth on his fur, too, and thinking to himself that if there was a place more warm, more friendly, and more cozy than this in the whole of Deep Wood, then it was the little house on Potter's Island, where the wild river flowed past. Old Stripe was making tea. The kettle was ready for him on the hearth. He measured out two fragrant heaps of dandelion tea into the pot and began chattering while he stirred. Now,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.